it's my pleasure and honor to present to you Lisa Parker, my dear friend for many years. I discovered Lisa during an international congress in Geneva. She was a teacher and I was a student. She has been a source of inspiration to all who have met her and had the chance to work with her. She's a refined musician, as well as an accomplished pedagogue for whom the relationship between teacher and student is as important as the musical material she teaches. One of her many qualities is to have made the Delprose method
an education
in music of highest level. Lisa has spent 37 years at Longy, Boston, as a professor of eurythmics, solfège and improvisation and pedagogy, and started the Longy Delprose program, which trained many fine Delprose teachers and continues to through the Summer Institute. So just welcome her.
And it sounds almost like an oxymoron, because I have found that everybody is frightened of solfège. It strikes fear into all of us, all of our hearts. And I've been pondering, whereas improvisation, you know, we think of free and we're going to have fun. So they seem to be a kind of a conflict with each other. And I have been asking myself, why are people so afraid of solfège? I've had many students at Longy. My life has been in conservatories, teaching classical musicians. So that's my background. And they're all scared of solfège too. And I wonder why. And I've come to the conclusion that the why of it has to do with how fast we teach. And like today was major thirds and minor thirds, and tomorrow's going to be perfect fourths, augmented fourths, and perfect fifths, and you know, and they just can't. We can't absorb like that. And there is so much material to go through, and teachers are under pressure to produce and to teach everything they know. But we know, as educators, as Delprose educators, that people don't learn like that. That learning is slow, and we have to be willing to let learning go through all of the areas of our being. Mental, certainly, the ear, the voice, the body, our imagination. It's all a process of integrating. And we have to be able to take the time to do that. So I'm an advocate of slow teaching and slow learning. And I thought, what would be the best way to do this with all of you? So I came to the conclusion that I would like to make you my class. Are you willing to be in? When it gets really harder and we need to get some individuals to perform solos and so on, that I have asked some people to be a class up on stage, but I would like to start with you. The first thing that I feel is important is to prove to people that their ear is already smart. That the ear is how we learn language. It's amazing, really, when you think of it, that children are born into a family and magically they begin to speak, and they've been hearing their parents talk and hearing other people talk, and then one day that becomes a language. That's all the ear that does that, and they're not aware of how they're doing that. So I would like you to put yourselves in that position of, this is your very first solfège class, and you're a beginner. And I'm going to ask you to sit up nice and tall in your chairs, and to echo me. As you follow the piano, scalar motion. If you find yourself in a wrong place, and for example, if you had better do, if you sing ya da di da da, and the piano is telling you to do ya da di da da, ya da, it's just a little ways away when you use a scale. So you're not that wrong. So you can adjust just quickly, okay? So, I don't have perfect pitch. Does anybody have perfect pitch here? Who has perfect pitch? Way up. Yeah, it's great. But, you know, perfect pitch people can tell me what key I'm in. But I'm going to start at the key of, oh. That's where we work. Okay, so here we go. Ready? And.
Thank you.
Oh dear. You're doing so well. Not hearing a thing. So, you can't hear it. How can you follow what you can't hear? If I play. Because that requires the learning that the brain has to do. So I'm sort of starting on the ground floor here with just your ear, but also your voice. Because I think the voice is another natural instrument we're born with. We're born with that ability and that desire to communicate, and that is verbal. And we also have the language of movement. So, did anybody find that it was difficult to do vocally? Everybody's able to sing. Good. All right, so let's add the body. And And I have invited some students to come up, and anybody can come, but I did invite the students to come. If anybody else would like to come, please. About our lives on this planet, you know, our adventures, our feelings. It's harmony that makes us feel sad or happy or triumphant or joyous. This is harmony. And so I think that to leave the body out, I mean, the feelings are in the body, right? That's where they reside. They aren't in some kind of mental construct. They are in the body, so everybody can feel them. So, this is more than I expected. That's coming. That's great. Okay, so what we are going to do is stand in a balanced way on both feet. And in a simple way. And I'd like you to tell me what chord this is. The one chord, right? It's the tonic chord. It's that chord which resolves all problems. We're only dealing with major keys. Sorry about that, but it's a question of time. So this is going to be the tonic chord. And you are going to stand there like a tonic chord until you hear something else. And then I would like you to react.
And intention.
an intention. Say more.
It wants to go somewhere.
Yes, absolutely. You can't stop. They say that that's how Mozart's wife woke him up in the morning. She would go to the piano and she would play. Mozart would go to the piano. So it needs resolution, and it has intentionality. I like that. Okay, so let's go on.
Thank you.
So this is our six. And what was this? This is the two chord, right? 2-7 chord. And it always ushers, it always goes to five. You hear jazz musicians playing, practicing their 2-5s. And jazz musicians, you know, have to use a lot of 2-5s. It can go anywhere, but it always goes to five. So 2-5. It ushers in a cadence. That's what I feel about the 2-chord. Whereas the 6-chord, it is a cadence, or it can go to 5. It can be part of a cadence, but 2 starts a cadence. All right, there's one that we haven't done. Inside hand, because we're going to do a little game. We're going to have fun. march, and anybody who would like to march with us is fine to come up on stage. Do you have a partner? Okay, good. So, just so you don't run into each other, just go wherever there is space. So, if I play the one chord, you are marching forward. If I play the five chord, you are marching backwards. Let's start with that. You might try it like this. However you like.
Thank you.
Okay, so now, I think, would you like to sit, can you sit on the floor and facing the board? I'm going to bring the board up. This is what I call my chord choir. Can you see? No, that's okay. Can you see?
Yes.
The board. Okay, so somebody give me a note. Okay, so that is the root of the one chord. Subdominant. The tonic chord needs both. If you're only on the side of the dominant, the one and the five, you begin to long for the four chord to balance things out. And the four has the two underneath it because it shares two pitches. It's almost this. It has the same function. It has a subdominant function. One and six. I don't know. Can you see the six?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Good. And three is related to five. Okay. And I have this as an option. So, do you remember your one chord? Good. If I point to one again, I want you to change your note. So if you're going, okay, so let's try that out.
Thank you.
you. Good. I turn the 2 chord into a major chord, it will function like a dominant chord. So, it's a dominant of what?
Five.
It functions as 5 and 5 of 5. It can even have a 7th chord. If I do the same thing to the 3 chord, Three equals five of six. And six, I turn that into a major chord. It's 5 of So let's start. Wait a second. I don't see us. So we have to know where we are starting, yes?
So we're not sure where one is. We are in the south. Is one?
Well, you have to know where one is. Yeah, there's one. That's the beginning of the tricord.
Yes.
One. It starts with you. All tricords are going to start with you. So here we have
2, 3, 4, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Have we got any half wind?
So
using numbers.
I'm going to borrow something
four, three, two, three, four, five, six, seven, one, seven, six. Three.
But we're supposed to make a melody, right?
Yes.
Two, three, four, five, six, seven, one, two, three, one.
Okay. Yeah.
That uses the half steps.
It does. It does. Can he have done it more economically?
Oh.
We want to make them as short as possible and still.
Oh, okay. I can do it first.
Okay, good.
Four, three, two, one, sev, sev, one.
Good. Let's everybody do that.
Two, three, four, three, two, one, sev, sev, one.
Good. That's it. Could somebody make it six, seven, one? Good. Leslie could. Let's have you look like the trichord. Yes.
Six, seven, one.
Everybody.
Six, seven, one, two, three, four, three, two, one.
Good. All right, so I'm going to give you another shot for it.
Five, six, seven, one.
that enough to 5, 6, 7, 1? 4, 3, isn't it? Yeah. How about you, Mike?
5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Good. So, all right. Thank you very much. I'm running out of time, so I want to get to sight singing, because sight singing can include improvisation. So I did copy out a piece of music which is not too hard. Keep one at the piano. And if you could pass those out to every couple of people. I'm not giving you a chance to sit down. Is there anybody who would like to sit down? Because they have the chairs.
Thank you.
be rhythmical. Who has an idea? We'll sing the same notes. But, well, that's changing the tempo a little bit. But let's change the meter. Let's change the meter so that we are going to adapt what we see to a meter.
Thank you.
there. I think it's a great stopping place. Maybe you want to ask some questions. But my belief is that a solfège can be really fun. And you can be inventive and you can change things around. All the while you are educating your brain to what you're already at. Thank you so much.
In the exercise of the different body positions to represent the different scale degrees, I had the feeling that different tonic chords felt different depending on where they are in the phrase. And I wonder if that is emphasized or if you should try to hear them as the same.
Well, the exercise was to identify chords rather than scale degrees. So the one chord has two scale degrees in it. It does make a difference. In the meter, where you place these particular scale degrees in harmony, makes a big difference. So that if you have something occurring on the downbeat, it has a certain effect. If it's a secondary beat, yes. The answer is that yes, that it does make a difference. Where it is placed, an anacrusic, which is the anacrusic chord of all of these on the board? The most anacrusic.
Quel est l'accord qui crée l'anacrusis?
5-7. Yeah, it's a 5-7 chord. It's anacrusic by nature, and then it goes to a resolution chord, which is crusic by nature. So Schumann actually loved to rearrange that. And you'll find a lot of, I don't know whether it's got a political message, a sort of anti-military message, but he loved to place the 5 chord on the downbeat and the 1 chord on the upbeat. And it's totally mixed up, and then you have to make it right at the end. Schumann was always playing games with rhythm. And I think, since he was a writer and a philosopher as well, I think there's a message there. I like to think so, anyway, anti-military message. But I'm speaking of... we would expect this to be... This game is really taken right out of Dalcroze. I fill in, the kids call it the Oreo cookie game, because that's 2 chocolate cookies with filling. And so the filling is on wider intervals, is more. But if you have this, what they're hearing. We're trying to educate the ear in Saltish. So my effort is to use what they know already. I don't believe in, you know, just starting out with everything. So the first exercise was just walking forward and backward. One is the tonic chord, one is the dominant chord. And the reason I have the dominant chord going backwards is that there's a tension, because you really want to go forward. So there is a tension, and you have to be ready to shift. Okay, I know two chords. And then we add the fourth chord, and then the sixth chord. I always do it in the same order, because it's sort of like the order of importance. One, four, and five being the basic pillars, and then six, substituting for one, that's a deceptive game. Two substituting, or two going to five when one is really a conventional feeling. And three is kind of a mysterious one, but it goes to four, goes to five, and it turns. But that's what I'm trying to do, and I love your image because it makes it, it lifts it beautifully, poetically.
So is there a last question somewhere? No? Everything is clear. So thank you again.